So today I'm going to talk about the countries which I visited in the summer 2015. And most of all, what I really want to emphasize during my whole presentation is the way to travel. Because I traveled solo, which sometimes is pretty unfamiliar to many people. And by means of this presentation, I just want to promote this whole idea of traveling solo and enjoying the local culture in the places which you visit. So as you can see on my map, I visited Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, the Philippines, then Indonesia, Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand. I did all that in 3 months. It was really good fun, and unfortunately I had to summarize most of it into a very short presentation today, so which should take around 90 minutes, and after that feel free to ask me any questions. So let's begin. As most of you don't know me at all, I have to introduce myself a little bit. My name is Ondřej, and I study Dutch language here at the Faculty of Arts. And I really love traveling. I've been traveling since I was 18. Every single summer, I just packed my bags and I left on my own completely. That's the kind of thing that, when you travel alone, or let's say solo, it's not something that comes to you just completely, you just pack your stuff and you leave for 3 months. That's something that comes to you gradually. So I always was trying to look for opportunities which I could take so that I could travel, because I'm a student, that means cheaply, and also that I could get the most out of the little money I had. Because the thing is that I was studying in Olomouc. I finished my bachelor in Olomouc, and I didn't really have much money to travel with, since I had to, spend every single coin on my own. So there are some tips I want to mention today. And apart from the mindset itself, because you need to really change your mindset a little bit when you travel on your own, that means that you need to become a little bit more sociable, but you're sort of forced on the way. And otherwise, you also need to be very flexible. That means that you don't have to plan, every single thing, but to a complete detail. You can just leave and see how it turns out. And the third, and most of all, you should feel ready to feel uncomfortable sometimes. That means either you feel homesick, or you are not satisfied with sleeping on floor, and so on. Okay, so that's the first thing that I have to mention. Why travel solo, actually, as a very beginning? I have to mention that if you travel solo, we are sort of forced to meet locals, which is crucial in my point of view, because when I travel, I really want to get the most out of the local culture. Most of the times when Czechs travel, they just go to the hotel with their friends or to a hostel, whatever, and then they just spend their time together. They don't get to meet so many locals afterwards, so that's not something that I really want when I travel. This kind of perception can, however, change in your life. And it's really entirely up to you how you want to spend your time. But today I'm promoting this kind of traveling. So when you're solo, people tend to think that then the person is alone. That's far from true, really far. Actually, when I travel solo, I feel a lot more sociable, and there are actually more people around me afterwards, which you will be able to see in pictures, which I will show you in a while. So the first option, which I can recommend to everyone who is about to start traveling, especially at an early age, it is actually to travel as a volunteer. Because when I was 18, I really didn't have much money, and the first and foremost, I tried to meet the locals again and help out, just completely for free. So I found this organization, which is mostly for Czechs and Slovaks, but you can find any other sending organization abroad, like SCI and so on. And then you can participate in various kinds of projects. You can participate in short-term and long-term projects. I mostly participated in short-term ones, which took mostly 2 weeks, up to 3 weeks. So then when you arrive, the project itself is usually focused on a very specific thing in that country. So then you mostly help the locals. I will show you some of my personal experience in a minute. And then you also work on it together with a group of international people. So the first thing is that you meet some new friends that are from abroad, and at the same time you get to meet locals who are you know, in that place, and you help them at the same time with absolutely no reward, because the reward is actually the accommodation itself, and also they pay you know, for all the food and drinks and so on, and also sometimes for the travel expenses. That depends how you organize it. Afterwards, you know, let's say, or before coming to the project, you must write a little motivation letter. I've always been admitted to work camp or this short-term project, so don't feel afraid, you know, you'll always get accepted, I think. Then you need to pay a little administration fee, which is around 2,200 crowns, Czech crowns. And if you go to the second project the very same year, you need to pay only half, so that means 1,100 crowns. And then you need to pay for your travel expenses. To be a little bit more specific, I actually, last time I traveled through this kind of projects was in 2014, and I was traveling for 2 months for 20,000 crowns. And I was in Georgia, Turkey, and all around Europe. So that's actually a pretty cheap way to travel around, and I can definitely recommend it as a good start for a solo traveler. Now, as I told you, there's a huge variety of projects themselves, and I'm going to show you some of them. My first work camp, or let's say this short-term project, was in Belgium in 2010, where we worked as a group of internationals. We were working at the theater festival, so actually we could just put on costumes, we were going on parades in town, we were attracting people, you know, to participate in that festival, and also afterwards we were working in a canteen where we actually were, you know, eating together with all the performers. So all the performances were for free. We could visit every single theater play for free, and we had a really good fun. All right, that was my first camp. My two other camps were in Germany. As I told you, there is a great variety. So then the two other projects were actually in ex-concentration camps in Germany. And those camps included archaeology. So we were actually on excavation site around the concentration camp, and the stuff we were digging out of the ground was actually, you know, things like porcelain with SS logos on it, or some teeth, you know, and things like that. So it was a little bit depressive, of course, but I mean, I learned a lot from this. And in the picture, you can see us actually in the restoration center working on the things we found, which later went to a museum nearby. Another great work camp was in Iceland in 2012. It also concerned archaeological works, but this time we were outdoors and we could enjoy the Icelandic nature a lot. And most of all, in our free time, we could travel around. And we had our own van, and we didn't have to pay a single coin, which was perfect, and I could save a lot of money while seeing the east of Iceland. So here, that was like the best sight from the east of Iceland, that it was waterfall, which I can highly recommend for anybody. Then it was Ireland in 2013. It was basically just a runaway for 2 weeks. We spent 2 weeks in a forest without any electronics, and it was really good fun because I could really turn off and I was completely out of civilization. So if somebody is like this natural person, you can definitely even, you know, find these kind of projects. Right, and my last project that I want to mention, although I've been to 10 probably, my last project was actually in Turkey in 2014, where I was organizing cultural activities for children and teenagers at the summer camp. So I really enjoyed that because actually I didn't consider that as work. So everything was paid for me, we had a lot of excursions around the place, and everything was for free, which was perfect. All right. Here's another tip I have to give you, and that is, it is called Couchsurfing. Can you please raise your hands if you have used Couchsurfing in the past? That's not that many, actually. That's not that many. Cool. I hope there will be a lot more after today. Couchsurfing itself is a platform for travelers. So let's say you can use it as a traveler or as a host. So right now I'm not traveling, I can become a host, and I'm actually probably hosting tonight. One guy over there, sitting right there, from Britain. And when you host, you can actually accommodate people for free. That means that if you have like 2 square meters of free space at home, you can just invite them, you know, and they can use a sleeping bag or a sleeping pad and so on. Or you can offer them, you know, like the other bed that is free in your room or in your flat. And it's called couchsurfing because most of the times you end up on a couch. So that's the really good way at first to save money, you know, because you don't have to pay for accommodation, not even a single coin. And the second way is that you meet the real locals who live on that place, and they can show you the best sites around. Then that's my way right now, you know, as a host. And then of course I can participate in various events that are organized in Prague. And most of the times it's like, you know, 50% of people who attend are locals, 50% are the people who are traveling. They are here, you know, just at the moment. And then if you travel, then you can use open or direct request. It's entirely up to you, because with open request, you write to the whole city, let's say. Let's say I write to Tokyo that I'm coming for 5 days. And you know, then I can expect some answers. So if people want to invite me on their own, they can do it from their own will. And I actually received dozens of invitations from many places around Asia. And then you can also do direct requests, which means that you write directly to somebody whom you can find on Couchsurfing. On Couchsurfing, every single person has a profile. And on that profile, there are references, which you should really pay a good attention to, because there, of course, like every single thing is dangerous, you know, like especially when you travel. So you need to pay really good attention to things around you. And the first thing, if you want to use Couchsurfing, is to check the references of the person you want to meet or stay with. So references are mostly, you know, positive, neutral, or negative. And if you see some negative reference, then you should already, you know, like be more cautious about it and not to stay with the person, especially if you are a solo girl traveling alone. That's much more dangerous for girls, of course. But I've met many girls traveling solo, so I see no reason why not to do it. Now, some funny experience from Couchsurfing. You will hear a lot more from Asia today, but here are some other experiences from other countries. My first experience through Couchsurfing was in 2012. I went to Iceland and I had 0 references. And with this guy over here, with Carl, we just exchanged a few phrases on Couchsurfing. And you know, this guy invited me to his place, and when I arrived, the guy wasn't there. But you know, it was fine because he actually left me a message that he would be at work and that the keys are in the boot box. So actually, I could just enter his place. You know, he has never met me, and you know, I could just enter his place and go inside. You know, and feel completely comfortable, like at home. And then I visited him, you know, at work. And after that, I found out that he was actually hosting 6 more people that were coming afterwards, and we had a huge party, and it was a huge international party in Reykjavik. It was really good fun. All right, that was the first and the first experience which sort of showed me this Couchsurfing spirit that you learn while traveling this way. My second crazy experience was in Ireland in 2013, and the thing was that I wanted to travel a little bit longer for about a week in Scotland. And the thing, things were pretty bad because I went bankrupt. I was completely out of money, and it's not my thing to ask my parents for money. And so I was looking for alternatives, and I was staying in Dublin for a few more days. So I asked my host, actually, who was a street artist, you know, like, do you know where I could earn some money, you know, just for a few days, so I can earn more money for future travels in Scotland? And he said, yeah, fine, let's go to the street, you know, we'll build some sand statues, which he was doing all the time. But this time he did it with me. And you know, like after a while, he left, and he left me there with the statue. And then I was just pretending to be an artist, and I was just, you know, using a brush, you know, to finish like the last details. And then, you know, I was surrounded after a while by hundreds of people. And the funniest thing afterwards was that, you know, like money was starting to pour in. And like, you know, after 3 hours, I received like 300 euros in 1 hour. I'm sorry, 3 hours, you know. So It's not finished yet because, you know, when I was surrounded, I was approached by people all the time. They were asking me where I was from, how long I've been doing that. Of course, I had to, you know, like, I had to lie, sort of. So I told them, you know, like, yeah, I'm just helping out my friend, you know. But yeah, you know, I'm the artist. And then, you know, one family arrived with a small child. And the father asked me, you know, I see that you have a huge pile of unused sand over here. Can you make something small for my daughter over here? And I was, you know, like so flabbergasted, so gobsmacked. I didn't know how to react. And I was just, you know, like staring at him like that. And then I guess his wife must have felt it, because the wife replied, the artist must be very, very tired after the whole day of making those statues. So, you know, of course, I confirmed that, you know, and then I left home, or like to my host's place with 300 euros in my pocket, and I survived the next week. So that was really good fun. I can highly recommend it, you know, like couchsurfing can serve, you know, as, you know, many ways for people. Right, let's begin with the countries that you came for. But at the very beginning, I want to show you always like a short cut of all the videos I've made in Japan and Korea, and later on the other countries. So let's have a look at it. I have it over here. General remark I have about Japan, that is the first thing that struck me immediately when I left the airport, and that's the discipline and patience of Japanese in general. Because you know, on floor, I could find those lines which are around you know, the public transport, and as it happens here usually, especially in the underground, you know, people once the door is open, everybody wants to get in, and nobody waits. You know, almost no one waits for somebody to get out. So here you could actually see them standing in queues like this. And then they were waiting when the train came, or any bus, any single public transport. And then they were waiting for people to go out, and then they entered afterwards. Which I found very interesting, because you know, it's not very typical in Europe, this thing. So most of all, I will try to pinpoint these contrasts in culture in every single country. And don't take my word for granted. Always do your research and trust that, you know, like, if you're a traveler, you cannot be very objective. So that's my whole, like, personal experiences. Right. Another general remark is that the craziness of Tokyo itself, because here we can see the labyrinth of the underground. As we all know, the Tokyo has 36 million people, is the biggest city in the world. And, you know, I was just a little bit outside the main circle, which is the green one in the middle. And I was hosted there by a Chinese girl. And it took me about 40 minutes to get there. And, you know, going to the end of one line would take you actually 4 hours, let's say. So it's pretty crazy. And once you get out of the center and you go to a metro station, all the stations are just in Japanese. So I was, you know, it was pretty difficult sometimes to find my way around when I was outside the center. And when I asked some locals, you know, for the way, they were really kind all the time. I guess they like, you know, European tourists a lot, especially, you know, when a person sees a solo traveler, everybody is much kinder to them, I guess. But every time I asked them for the way, I just said, let's say, I want to go to Nishimagome, where I was staying. And they said, yeah, Nishimagome, it's over here. And they pressed it already on the machine, and the ticket went out already, and they used their own money. And I told them, like, okay, can I pay you for that at least? I mean, no, it's yours. And actually, you know, if I offered them money for it, they would be even insulted. It is their, let's say, pride, you know. So it was very interesting, because this happened on its own a few times, completely independently, you know. So that's why I wanted to mention it, at least. Another huge thing that happens, or which I saw in Japan, is how everything busy is, you know, like, everything is super busy, everybody's rushing everywhere, and I felt a little bit depressed in Tokyo after 4 days, because, you know, of all the people around me, I didn't feel much of personal space. But at the same time, you go to a shopping center and you can hear classic music, which is something I, you know, found very interesting, because, you know, once you go to shopping centers here or some supermarkets, then you can hear mostly, you know, like, pop music and advertisements, right? But I mean, in Japan, almost every single shopping center I went to had classic music playing. And it was also quite visible from the interests of Japanese themselves, because many Japanese actually can play some instrument, and almost all my Japanese friends knew some Czech composers, which is pretty interesting. All right, now let's move on. Another general remark is that I found Northeastern Asia very disciplined and very clean. So that means, like, all the streets were super tidy, and nobody was even trying to think, you know, like, to put a cigarette, you know, after finishing a cigarette, you know, to just throw it on the ground. And cigarettes were also bad. I mean, smoking on the street was strictly forbidden, and Japanese tend to follow rules quite well. And over here we have, you know, in the picture we have this kind of glass box, which was present at every single metro station. And in those glass boxes, you know, they were like, everybody was really quick, you know, with finishing the cigarette, and then they were leaving. And only once it happened to me that actually someone was smoking outside this glass box. And this guy was really quick, so that nobody would see him. And then he took, you know, as I told you, like, Japanese are very clean, you know. So then he took out the tissue, and then he put the rest of the cigarette in the tissue, and he put it in his pocket, like this. So that's something, you know, okay, I broke the rule, but I will remain very clean, you know. That was very funny, at least. All right, here's the first specific remark I have from Japan. And those are the game centers, which are very specific in Japan. We have, of course, we have arcades, but they are mostly for, like, you know, teens, and it's not very common to see them. And but, you know, on the other hand, in Japan, it's very common. And the thing is that you can see every single social class present there, and also every age. So at the same time, you could see, you know, like some machines with some games about manga, you know, and like comic from comic books and so on. And you could see that there was a manager in a suit playing it, and at the same time there was some granny playing it next to him, you know. And right next to the granny there was a child playing the very same game. That was something that I found very interesting. And especially the place is like, you know, super noisy. And you know, like, you can see all the lights around, so you felt like at a party actually. And it was pretty interesting to see that you know, the demand comes from every single age and from every single social class. So it seems like, you know, Japanese tend to spend a lot of their free time over there. Another thing that I experienced through couchsurfing is that I met one woman from Japan and three other couchsurfers that she was hosting. Those other couchsurfers were from Spain. And she actually had a good connection with some guy working at the fire station. And actually only because of her, we could get inside to experience the earthquake training, you know, how to behave during an earthquake. This is an obligatory training for teenagers, and we were actually there with Japanese teenagers who are, you know, 14, 15, and they were taking part in this training. So the things that we were practicing is actually how to behave during a fire. So there was this artificial flat, and you know, there was again artificial smoke, you know, coming in, and we had to, you know, like, crawl in a flat, and then we were, you know, they taught us how to deal with, you know, like, how to handle the fire extinguisher, and of course, you know, the icing on the cake was actually the platform, which you can see in the picture over here. And the platform was actually a simulation of an earthquake. And there was, you know, like, we have those, we have that scale of Richter up to 10, and it was simulating, you know, number 7, so the 7th degree of earthquake. And it was pretty intense, actually. I didn't expect that, even though it was a simulation. And they just told us, you know, just get under the table and put some pillow over your head. And I told them, like, okay, but what should I do, you know, on the street? And they told me, like, yeah, just pray for the best. That's it. You are, you know, it's like, when it's like 8.8 degrees, then you would be very lucky, actually, you know, like, even in the building. You know, something really heavy might fall on your head and so on. So that's something that, you know, Japanese have to live with. And those earthquakes is not something that is occasional. And those trainings are actually compulsory for every single Japanese team. So it was pretty crazy to see them screaming there, you know, like in that, you know, in that flat where we had to crawl and so on. Yeah, right. Now I can move to Nagoya, where I spent 3 days with a Japanese family. I could get there only because of my good connection from a voluntary project I did, because otherwise I was mostly hosted by Chinese expats, actually, who are not that conservative when it comes to inviting strangers to their homes. And in the Japanese family, they were really kind. I mean, they, you know, they don't, let's say, invite you just for granted like that, but once they invite you and you are their guest, then they, you know, you are basically part of the family in a way. So they were teaching me, you know, a lot of typical Japanese traditions on how to drink tea, and they were showing me, you know, how to write, you know, like, there are those three writings in Japanese. And I was teaching their son, you know, some English, and it was very good, and I really enjoyed it. And as you can see in the picture, as I told you, like, generally, the Japanese family is quite conservative, and there are actually many, many families that live together, I mean, like, three generations all together. So there are grandparents, parents, and, you know, like, kids, you know, basically. Right, and their whole house was built in a very typical Japanese style. So there were those moving doors, calligraphy on the wall, And you know, here we can see a table where we actually sat, but of course they had their own traditional table where we were just, you know, sitting on the floor, which was really nice. When I told them that I would like to see sumo fighters, and I know that it's like very expensive and it comes to tournaments, you know, which you have to pay for, and they actually told me that there's, you know, in the city, that there's like a local sumo training, you know, that I could attend for free. And so, you know, they took me there in the morning. And, you know, when it comes to sumo, I had some, of course, you get some prejudice, you know, you think something before you even meet them. And I thought, you know, like sumo are basically like fat guys with good techniques how to destroy your balance. But I was proved wrong after a little while. And when I saw their training, it actually starts at 7 in the morning. It's 5 times per week. And of course they eat a lot of fat foods, and you know, they need to stay really fat. But at the same time, they were doing, you know, like poses and that kind of training I wouldn't be able to handle. So they were stretching a lot. I mean, one of the guys was actually able to put, you know, his legs completely, you know, like, let's say, to 180 degrees angle, which I would never be able to do, no matter how thin I am. And actually they were quite muscular, they are not just fat, because when I saw them, you know, like fighting in the ring, they were, you know, I could see their muscles, you know, just below their skin. And it was, you know, when I saw that, I just thought those guys would just kill me. You know, if I were in the ring and I would go against them, you know, I wouldn't survive them, I think. So that was something interesting to learn from sumo. You know, the guy on the left was actually just 14 years old and he started doing this this stuff. And still, sumo is the kind of thing that you do on your own. I mean, you decide and you just take up those trainings and so on. But on the other hand, there's one thing that I experienced, and that's geisha in Japan. And that's the kind of thing that, you know, parents decide for you. So geishas are actually taught at schools from a very early age, and nobody even asked them, because their parents just enrolled them for that course. And I was lucky enough to learn a lot from Tsuname, which was one girl from couchsurfing. And she actually knew a lot, a great deal about geishas. So she took me to the historic center of Kyoto, and she told me a lot how geishas live and how they even, you know, got this job. What she told me is actually that in that traditional city center called Gyo, there are many traditional restaurants and pubs where geishas actually work. But in order to get there, you have to pay a tremendous amount of money. And most of all, you know, it's better to be Japanese, because they mostly do it for locals. And geishas, there's nothing sexual about it. It's simply just to be a good company to your host, you know, and so on. So they should really know singing, dancing, you know, they should really be a great company for any manager. And here on the wall, we can actually see that, you know, geishas have fake names, and those fake names are actually here on the wall. And so if a manager comes into that place, he can ask for a specific geisha, who should come and, you know, like serve him during the night and so on. The thing that struck me the most is not the thing that they start from a very early age and nobody even asks them, but the thing is that those managers actually sometimes hire geishas and they pay them a tremendous amount of money just to become sort of a second unofficial wife, which was something that I really didn't expect. But the thing is, you know, there's nothing, again, nothing sexual about it. The thing is that the manager, or this rich guy, actually pays for her virginity. So geishas should stay virgins, that's the first thing. And also, if some guy actually pays really a lot of money so that she would be only with him, she is actually completely dedicated to one guy without anything sexual about it. So that's something that really was super interesting when I was there. Now, let's move to South Korea. In South Korea, Japan was strictly a cultural experience, but in Korea it was sort of like mixed with culture and a lot of partying, because you know, South Korea is actually quite underrated when it comes to parties, especially in Seoul, but I'll get to that. So I started in Busan, and in the picture we are in, on Busan's beach, and you know, everybody is like really open-minded, and they eat raw fish over there, because right there are markets. And you can actually buy a fish that you point at, and the fish is still alive. And the thing is that octopus is actually very typical for that place. And so the thing I did, like a normal local, is that I just came there and I bought an octopus that was alive, and I started eating it alive. I mean, I just, you know, like grabbed the octopus like that, and I, you know, started eating just the head off. And then, you know, she chopped it into small pieces, and every single piece was still moving. Like you saw in the video probably, that when I put it in my mouth, I mean, those tentacles were still coming out, you know? They tried to escape, I guess. And the thing is that, here's my first general remark about Korea, is that the Korean girls are very shy. I mean, every time they were, you know, like checking me out, and when I, you know, looked back at them, they were, you know, shy, and they always tried to pretend they never saw me. But then, you know, they just came to that fish market and they grabbed an octopus and ate it like that. You know, and that's something that, like, it's like a huge contrast with Czech girls, I think, because, you know, Czech girls are not that shy, I think. But when it comes to eating an octopus alive, I think not a single girl would actually touch an octopus like that. Right? So that's something that I saw as a huge contrast. In Busan, I actually visited, I met some couchsurfers. The girl next to me is actually my host from Busan. I had two hosts, and she also invited a guy from the Netherlands and also a guy from Bangladesh. So we were, like, four of us were going around and enjoying the city atmosphere. And we also visited slums in Korea, but they were not that poor if I compare them with the ones in the Philippines. So it was very nice there because people had really, like, you know, very modest living, and they invited us for a coffee, you know, to go inside and talk with them and so on. Right. So now, you know, when I went to the city or any single underground and so on, especially Koreans are quite obsessed with electronics. When it comes to, you know, like smartphones and so on, they take pictures all the time, they take selfies. And if you go in a very busy street, you know, there are actually selfie sticks all around you, and you have to pay really good attention not to hit any with your head. So actually there are, you know, like hundreds of people taking selfies, you know, on that beach as well. And one of the Korean girls I talked with, actually she showed me, you know, she was showing me something or a cell phone, and she had this folder on her phone, and it had 5,000 selfies on it. So I just thought, like, oh my god, I mean, is it really necessary to take 5,000 selfies? I mean, of course you need 100 filters to put it, you know, before you put it on Instagram. And this brings me to another general remark in Korea, and that is that Koreans, or let's say in Japan, they were still very traditional. They preserved their real values that they had, but in Korea, Korea was changed in a way that the American culture was imported there quite a lot. I could see that. And the only thing they felt national about was actually music. So, I mean, K-pop is like a brand, you know, that's worldwide. But apart from that, Koreans sort of lacked the identity they used to have, in my opinion. So, you know, they are quite, you know, the values that they have is that it's quite superficial, you know. Everybody cares about their looks. I could see that a lot. And actually when I talked with my friend about the Korean culture in companies, then actually what he told me struck me really hard, and that is that, you know, if you are not good looking, you have really, you know, lower chances to get accepted and, you know, work somewhere, especially as a girl. And apart from that, there's a huge respect for age. So people who are, you know, older, they get really, they deserve a lot of respect in Korean and Japanese culture. And the thing, you know, I used to work with Koreans when I was from like 16 to 18. And the thing I saw there is that sometimes the managers were old, they were older, but they were lacking basic skills. And sometimes they were just on that post because they were old, you know, because they were paying respect to their age rather than their qualifications. But it's of course not something that, you know, we can generalize. And most of all, there's a huge pressure in society that, you know, the society drives you to be the best, to have the best marks and to become the best in your field, because there are so many Koreans living on such a small space. And the same goes for Japanese, and therefore I guess the depression must go up, especially when there's no personal space around you, and suicide rates are actually pretty high in Japan and Korea. So I guess it might be one of the causes that, you know, like your family and your friends drive you to be, you know, like force you to be the best. And if you fail, then it's like a complete humiliation, not just for yourself, but for your family as well. So that's something I really wanted to mention. Now, let's be more specific and let's talk about relationship with Japan. The thing is that talking about, especially modern history, talking about it in Japan was a huge taboo. It's like asking a girl's age, actually, something like that. And, I asked a little bit about it in Japan when I asked some young generation and what they, you know, people of my age, basically. And when I asked them about it, they actually told me that it's up to interpretation of each teacher to, you know, to present that history to people, especially when it comes to imperialistic times of Japan. And when I asked about it in South Korea and other countries, Japanese were seen in a complete negative way most of the times. There's only one exception, which I will talk about in Taiwan. But in general, like, this relationship was very deeply rooted, you know. And especially in South Korea, they saw Japanese in the most negative way. And when I asked them why, it is because when they came to Korea, they were not killing anybody like they were doing in China and so on, and the Philippines and so on. But in Korea, they tried to change their culture. So basically, they arrived and they thought that they would be able to change Koreans into Japanese. And so they actually started, you know, to abolish speaking Korean, writing Korean. They abolished the Korean books, and slowly they were turning Korean, especially new generation, into Japanese. And when I talked with one guy about it, he told me that his grandfather couldn't actually write in Korean, and he had to learn it after the Japanese had left. So that was pretty intensive to hear, actually, that they were just, you know, there to change the, you know, identity of the people. So that's something that was quite different in other countries. Other countries just didn't like them. But they always admitted that they improved the infrastructure, they provided education, and so on. In the picture, you can see also my two friends who are from my other voluntary projects. Let's move to parties in Seoul, because actually, you know, when I went to Seoul, I didn't know what to expect, and I went to the center completely with one of my friends. And I was completely tired, and I didn't expect any big party. And when I arrived in a district called Hongdae, actually, I saw that the party is not happening in clubs, but it is happening on the street. So that means that there were actually street artists playing different kinds of music. There was a K-pop and K-pop dancers, you know, like those typical teen Korean girls dancing. And then there was also this sight that I could see. And those were actually Koreans, you know, with headphones, and each of them had some specific music in it of their liking, and they were partying together like that, in complete silence, which was pretty strange to see. So, and you know, everybody was super open-minded. You could just go there completely on your own, and you could meet people like that. That's also kind of thing that you can enjoy traveling solo. Right, there was this spontaneous trip I did only thanks to Couchsurfing, and that was this mud festival in Boryang. And I went to Boryang, you know, I wanted to go there, but I didn't know who to go with. And my Couchsurfing host actually told me, you know, you can just come with us. We are 10, and you know, there are like, you know, Koreans, Japanese, and Chinese going all together. I was the only foreigner from the Europe over there. And when we went there and we rented the whole flat, and we had a huge party over there, and it lasted for like 2 days, the whole festival. You saw most of it actually on in the video, so I don't want to describe it in that much into detail. Let's move to Taiwan. In Taiwan, I visited Taipei, the capital, but I'm going to talk about Hualien the most, which is the town to the south, in the middle of Taiwan. And this place is typical for Aboriginal tribes, especially Taroko and Amis tribe in Hualien. After that, I went to Sinchun, where I finished my trip. Right, right now I'm going to show you again a little cut from Taiwan.
If it was your last day on Earth, where would you want to be? Would you find a place where love is a language and the light inside you shines as bright as the sun? Who would you share it with? That moment, lost in the arms of music. When time stands still, when all the days of your life fade into oblivion, remember the day you found home.
As I told you, in Hualien it was a very cultural place, and I was lucky enough that when I arrived there was this huge Aboriginal festival coming. And you know, in the picture you can see me just sitting, you know, between the Amis tribe, that's the one in the red and black, and in the white is the Taroko tribe. And I was lucky enough that actually one of my hosts from Couchsurfing was one of the members of Taroko tribe. And you know, when he told me that, you know, like, of course, you know, you can dance with us and you will be like a VIP at the festival, I can show you around. Of course, I didn't hesitate, you know, and I just went there directly. And, you know, the festival itself was really amazing because you could try many handicrafts of the local tribes. And there were also, you know, like individual dancings of like dance performings of each tribe. And in the end, you could join the tribes and dance with them in a complete circle, you know, and in a complete trance. So that was very, actually, a huge cultural experience for me, and I really enjoyed it. Then we could travel around the Taroko National Park, which is a beautiful place with a lot of high mountains and a lot of Buddhist temples on top of those mountains. We just swam in a river for a while, which was really good fun. And you know, that's the member of the tribe, you know, Dylan, who was my host. He actually told me a lot about the places around, and he brought us there with car, which also saved us a lot of time and a lot of money as well. This is one of the, you know, this is the view from one of the Buddhist temples on top of those mountains. And over there, it was just us and Buddhist monks. And I was there just with one of my friends. He was also hosting a guy from France. And we were there, you know, just checking their place, their kitchen and so on. And, you know, right there, we were going around and there was a group of monks just studying the scripture and praying and so on. And as you can see, the guy on the left is very interested in the scripture as he's lying on the table, right? But in general, like, it was a very peaceful place. It was like paradise, actually, because, you know, if I looked just behind my back over here, then I would see the view just before, like this one. So it was an incredible place, and very calm and peaceful. When I came back, I continued, you know, spending my time with tribes. And Dylan actually brought me to a huge feast and a dinner with his friends from the tribe. And, you know, I saw it as a great opportunity to, you know, like, present them with Czech alcohol. They got drunk immediately, and, you know, because generally they drink, you know, weaker alcohol. And, you know, after they tried it, I mean, tribals, they love dancing and they love smiling and so on. So after that, we started dancing around the table, as you saw in the video, right? When I was dancing there with this drunk, funny lady. So she actually suddenly, you know, she just presented me with some video on her phone, and we were supposed to imitate the dancing from the phone, and I just said, yeah, what the hell, why not? I mean, it was good fun. And Dylan was really kind that he was also serving, you know, like, or he was like my interpreter over there. So I could actually talk with them about anything. And of course, they just knew their own language and Chinese, because those tribes are pretty well integrated and most of them have jobs already and so on. I also visited some more traditional tribe, which was in the Philippines, and it was in the jungle, but I will talk about it in a while. So, when I went to the Philippines, I visited three huge places over there, two islands, and then the capital. So it was the island Cebu, where I mostly did like natural sightseeing. And then Palawan, which is a very touristic place nowadays, but I tried my best to stay like with locals. And then Manila, which is the capital of the Philippines and the place of the biggest contrasts I've ever seen in my life. I will describe it a little later. Those red lines over there are basically spontaneous trips. So that means those natural sightseeings. Of course, El Nido, which is this typical place for like scuba diving and island hopping and so on. And just to the south of Manila, there was a Taal volcano. So we could climb the volcano and play golf over there. It was pretty good fun. Let's start with some general remarks from the Philippines. The first thing is that already from Japan, I heard some pretty bad prejudice against the Philippines. They actually told me that, you know, that country is poor and that, you know, crime rates are really high and that I should be really careful and so on. But on the other hand, I also heard, like, you know, basically from the internet, I found out that, you know, the Filipinos are very friendly people. And it was confirmed once I stepped out of the airport, because I was planning to go to my host's place on, you know, on foot, and one guy on a motorcycle just stopped. You know, he saw me going there on foot, and he just, you know, said like, "Hey, where are you going? You know, like, where can I take you?" He was sort of like a taxi, you know. And I told him, "Yeah, I mean, there's one guy hosting me, and you know, I'm going to Bigfoot. It is this kind of studio where my host lived." And he told me, "Yeah, that's also on my way. I mean, I can take you there, for, you know, why not?" So actually, I just hopped on his motorcycle and we went there. It was incredible, this kind of friendliness from completely unknown people. And there's one huge contrast with public transport, because already from the Philippines, the transport itself changed a lot. You know, you can see that very colorful van actually passing by. And that's so-called jeepney. They use it in the Philippines quite a lot. And those are very small vans that they color on their own and that they tweak, you know, basically. I can show it to you over here. Because actually, what they did, there was an American army. I don't want to say occupying, but it was, you know, American army was present in the Philippines until the end of 60s. And when they left all of their jeeps, you know, over there. And what Filipinos did is actually they took those jeeps and they turned it into this kind of huge, funky van, you know. And then each guy, the driver, actually was basically a businessman on his own. And if you wanted to go somewhere, there were no official buses, there were no trains. The only way you could go there was actually, you know, like to take the jeepney. So they actually, you know, like covered most of the demands over there. The Philippines are actually very religious when it comes to Christianity. And most of the times, those vans and jeepneys were covered by quotes from the Bible and also the pictures of Jesus. which was I found very interesting actually. And it's also a very local way to travel around, so you don't get to see much tourists. Every time I hopped on that van, you know, the jeepney, it was very small and I was always hitting my head. That's the first thing. But then all locals were checking me out, like what I was doing there, you know, where did I come from and so on. So I always had very interesting chats with people while going somewhere, and they, you know, yeah, you have no idea where you are going, because at first there's no schedule when it goes and where it goes. So you just need to ask the driver, and the driver doesn't speak English, right? So that was sometimes it was quite a problem, but I always found my way around. I always asked people, you know, that we are going somewhere. So that was pretty interesting, actually. Another thing that you can try in Cebu, that's quite a touristic thing though, is that you can just snorkel or even scuba dive with sharks, whale sharks to be more exact. Don't worry, those sharks don't eat meat at all, they just eat plankton. And those are just babies. They attract them by pouring plankton in the water. And those babies that are 6 meters, you know, like long, they just come to eat plankton, and you can swim with them and so on. So that was quite an interesting experience. And the guy in the picture is actually my next host from Palawan, and he was kind enough to come because he had never done it before, and he came to Cebu, and we swam together there, you know, and then we hiked some waterfalls. And in Palawan, he actually showed me a lot of interesting places which only locals see. And also, he was working in a company that dealt with island hoppings. So I had some pretty good insight into, you know, like traveling around Palawan. When I arrived in Cebu, I also met one girl from Couchsurfing who was also traveling there. She was from Kenya, and her name was Kimia, which was also quite funny. And I traveled with her around, you know, especially to villages. You can imagine that those villages had around 500 people, let's say. And when we arrived, can you imagine, like, you know, a black girl and white guy stepping out of a bus, you know, or like the jeepney, and, you know, suddenly all the life stopped in that village. You know, we were completely surrounded. After a while, it felt almost like the whole village came to see us. And everybody was trying to, you know, offer us some help and, you know, like, where do you want to go, where do you want to hike? So we ended up going on a motorcycle like this, four of us, which is not very safe actually. But in Indonesia I even saw something scarier, and that was actually that in Indonesia they put wooden planks on a motorcycle like this, and two girls were balancing it from each side. So they were just sitting on wood like that, and they were going, you know, like 80 kilometers per hour, you know, just somewhere. So that was still quite, let's say, quite safe. Another funny thing is that on the way, there were no gas stations. You know, like we can imagine, you know, like petrol station, ordinary, right? You have a building, you pour petrol in your car, in your motorcycle, and then you leave, right? In there, it was a very different story, because actually, there were, you know, just very improvised shacks, and in those shacks, there were just glass bottles of Coca-Cola in it. And in those bottles, there was the petrol. And you could just saw, you know, one granny sitting there in that shack with her, basically with her son, probably. And they owned that business. And when we arrived there, they just took, you know, like one bottle with petrol, bottle of Coca-Cola, it felt like in the 90s. And they poured it inside the motorcycle, which was very interesting. I mean, that's a huge cultural shock. Here's a very big cultural thing I did in Palawan, not even locals knew about, because I asked them, you know, like, where can I see Batak tribe, you know, and they asked me, Batak tribe, where are they from? And I told them, like, they are here in Palawan, I mean, what the hell? So I found that information actually on a blog of one Korean traveler, and I'm glad I did, because they are pretty well hidden in jungle. And the only way to get there is actually to just tell driver to stop on a very random place. And then you just need to go to this Batak Visitor Center, it's called. And then you get a guide who doesn't speak English. And then you just venture in the jungle for about 2 hours. We had to cross several rivers, just like that. And then we arrived in this beautiful, kind of very tiny village with tribals. I was lucky enough actually to meet teachers who were teaching them, you know, like some basic skills like how to write and so on. And they were paid by the government grant, and they could speak English pretty well. So they helped me as interpreters, and I could actually spend time with the tribe with absolutely no language barrier afterwards. So when I arrived, and they were very shy, and they were just, you know, sitting on the patio, and you know, I arrived with some gifts to make them, you know, like feel more comfortable. And the gifts I brought were actually rice, some soups, and coffee. And the last but not least, actually, was the lighter, because, you know, they are still hunters, and they need, you know, like, of course they know how to make fire, but it would help them out for sure. And when they saw the lighter, you know, like suddenly they were so happy, and you know, they just took that lighter immediately, and you know, instead of making fire out of it and you know, cook some meat on it, what they did was actually that one guy rolled a cigarette. That's was something unexpected, and you can see him here smoking, you know, completely smiling, you know, at me, and he was enjoying it a lot. On the left, there's a woman, like, you know, topless, and. That was a very typical thing in the tribe, which actually was very interesting, that it was just 2 or 3 hours from a big city with, like, let's say, civilization. And you just venture into the jungle for 2 hours and you see this traditional tribe. That was very interesting. I could actually enter the lessons, and I was teaching the children there for a while. They even invited me to stay longer, but I had to refuse because I had to catch a plane afterwards. And you know, they were very enthusiastic. We were dancing together. I was teaching English, and we had a really great time, actually. So now I'm moving to Manila. Manila is a place of huge contrast, as I have already mentioned. What it means is that this, the center of the city is very rich. I mean, it's like you feel like in Western Europe, let's say. And also the prices are like that. But once you go outside the center, you see the real face of Manila. That means, you know, slums, basically, most of the times. And it's also not very, it's not uncommon to see, you know, like one street, and on one side you have a skyscraper, and on the other side you have a slum, and people living in tents. So I also felt, you know, like that the middle class was sort of missing from that country. Here, I have now moved to the slum part, which was actually a very strong experience, and I decided to make a video just about the slums. So let's check it out. very sad, I decided to put something funny at the end. I tried something typical Filipino at the end, and that's the duck embryo. It's actually a duck which is 9 days old, and it's already inside this egg. And you can just open the egg and you can see the embryo inside, basically a sort of living duck in a way. And you know, I found it very disgusting, you know, especially to look at. But it was actually quite tasty in the end. And what you do is just, you know, you just put it in your mouth like that, and that's it, you know. So yeah, that was so that it wasn't that sad. Now, the slums themselves, you know, I could see them again only because of Couchsurfers, because of local people who actually knew those places, and it was not really that far away from the center. What we had to do was, you know, we had to wait until the train, you know, passed, and then we just put this kind of carriage on the railroad, and we went, you know, on our own like that. We arrived at the bridge, and you know, the bridge had two railways, right? But I mean, against us there was some train coming, and it was on the same railroad like us. And actually, you know, I told the guy, you know, like, come on, like, it's okay, there's a train going at us. And he said, yeah, yeah, it's fine, it will go on the other track. And fortunately it did, just about 50 meters in front of us. And you know, they were basically like children on that bridge from the slum, you know, jumping in the water in very polluted river, and it was already very depressive scenery just to go there. Once we arrived, you saw that actually I bought some food and I distributed some food to them, and you know, everybody was happy, and everybody wanted to talk with me, like, you know, why do that and so on. And you know, I expected those places to be a little bit dangerous, since all the locals actually told me, why would you go there? I mean, it's dangerous. Those are slums. You know, you might be robbed, whatever. You know, they see, especially when they see foreigner, right? And I told them, yeah, I mean, do they have weapons? No. Okay, I will do that. You know, like, no matter what. So that was the first experience that I could see only through my friends from Couchsurfing. After that, we continued to a place called Hidden Tunnel, and that was in that, you know, black tunnel that you saw. And actually, there are people living just under the bridge, and they have nothing. Basically, they just lie on the ground. That's it. And they, you know, their children have nothing to wear, and so on. So it was very depressive to be there. And actually, even though I consider myself to be quite emotionally strong, it was a place where I couldn't bear it, and I actually started crying when I was there. The thing is that you learn something from seeing that, and that is to appreciate the things we have. Because even though we consider it normal to have a drinking tap water, to have a warm bed, that's something that not many people appreciate, and they take it for granted. And actually, for a huge part of the population on the planet, that's exactly like a dream. It's basically, you know, the thing that they dream about. Another of the slums, slum parts, was actually a landfill. You know, the place where they put a lot of waste on the huge piles. And the people over there, they were earning their living by recycling the waste. So imagine waking up every single morning in your tent made out of some cloth, and you go out and you start recycling the waste that some truck just pours, you know, in front of you. And then you earn, let's say, $4, you know, for recycling that part. What you do in a few hours, and for those $4 you just buy some food to survive, and then you go to bed again, you know. So that's the kind of life I saw there. And despite that fact, those people were very positive and you know, very kind when I arrived. So you know, I expected them to be a little bit hostile, but the opposite was the truth, actually. Then the last part, when you saw me actually building a wall, there was this part of slum called San Andres. And in there, you know, that slum had burnt out, or, you know, a few years before, before I got there. And there were actually even international volunteers working on some sort of work camps, like I told you about. And they were participating there for about 1 month, you know, to build walls and to, you know, help the locals. And they were working together with locals on that. And the worst thing was that, you know, once I stepped out of their house, I could saw, you know, the skyscrapers right next to me. You know, just that was that crazy, actually. So those huge contrasts actually can teach you something. And if you go to Manila, you know, like, don't forget to see the real Manila just outside the center. To make it a little bit less serious, the very same day, as I told you, Manila is full of contrast. So the very same day, I went to Ringside. It is a special kind of place where you can see Tyrion Lannisters fighting in a ring. So there were about 8 of them, and you know, they were using oil, you know, and they were really crazy fights. And you know, then they just came to me, they wanted to chat, I gave them some money, you know, because that's probably why they came. And you know, we took a great picture together, but those were not like the real fights. It was sort of like wrestling, you know, like from America. So I was there for about 1 hour, and I spent 1 hour laughing basically all the time. It was really good. Right, let's move to Indonesia finally. Indonesia is a huge contrast with the Philippines in a way of culture, because Indonesia is really a Muslim country. And the funny thing is that from the Philippines I already heard some specific prejudice about the country. And that is that Indonesians and the Muslims, you know, they told me that they do black magic. And I, you know, I asked them, like, in the Philippines, you mean black magic like from Harry Potter, right? I mean, like, you know, having some spells or whatever like that. And they said, yeah, I mean, we are not kidding, we are not kidding. I thought they were just joking. And, you know, I asked around Indonesia and around Malaysia and so on. And they actually told me that, you know, some local people in villages and so on, they actually mixed their previous, you know, pagan religion with Islam. And they turned it into this kind of voodoo kind of stuff, you know. So that I mean, I thought it was just some fun, but I mean, that was pretty crazy. They meant it very seriously. My way basically was just from Jakarta to Bali, and I had no idea where to stop on the way. So all those stops were very spontaneous. I mostly visited some natural sites and some cultural sites. And in the picture over here, you can see Mount Bromo. It's a volcano, a very typical place for tourists to visit. And let's start from Jakarta. Jakarta itself was very boring, actually. I mean, it was just a very dirty city. But the thing that struck me the most over there is that on the very same street, you can see the cathedral, and on the other side, you can see a mosque. The thing is that this cathedral, you can see that it has these white towers, right? Minarets. The cathedral was built by a Muslim architect, and the mosque was built by a Christian architect. The mosque is over here. You can see that it's not a very traditional mosque, right? And the thing is that there are just 10% of population are Christians in Indonesia. And I found it very interesting that they actually, you know, like, placed it on the same level in Jakarta. And I must say that, you know, Indonesians were possibly the friendliest people I've met on my journey. And I will tell you some, you know, certain and specific experiences later on. Good. Now, Green Canyon. That was a very spontaneous trip I did with 10 Indonesians. I met one host who was hosting me in Jakarta, and they were going on a very spontaneous trip to Green Canyon. What we did, actually, we had the life vests, and we just jumped in the river and we went by the stream. And we were going for about a few kilometers, and we had really impressive sights on the way. So then we were jumping from cliffs, you know, and we were having a lot of fun. So that was the group of Indonesians I traveled with, just local experience again. Let's move on. In Yogyakarta, that was a very cultural place with old Buddhist temples. I can highly recommend it, but it's very touristic. The thing there that I just stranded in a very minor streets where I could try some typical Javanese handicrafts. And there I'm again with a friend of mine from Couchsurfing, and we are trying out some Javanese handicraft, and that is that we have this melted wax and we use it on a piece of cloth to write something. Of course I sucked at it, I mean it was pretty bad with me, but my friend was doing pretty well. Now, in Indonesia, I enjoyed natural sites the most, and I decided to make a short video from the natural sites I visited. So let's check it out again. It's over here. heard that if you go to Indonesia, don't miss on amazing spots of nature which you can visit. Let's move on. On my way, I actually just talked with one girl for about 5 minutes. A complete casual chat, you know. And she told me, you know, like, if you're going to Bali, on the way you can stop in Jember. There's a huge carnival coming up, and, you know, feel free to come. And I asked her, you know, well, but I'll be traveling with my friends, and have you got some tips for us where we can stay just overnight? And she said, it's okay, you can stay in my place. You know, that was the kind of friendliness I got in Indonesia, I mean, from almost everybody. Everybody was interested, you know, like in getting to know us, you know, or me. And also, like, everybody was offering, you know, their place even for the night. So I sometimes felt I even didn't need couchsurfing, you know. Like, you might say I'm crazy that I want to stay with a stranger overnight, but it was just a girl of my age, you know, just like that. So, and a Muslim as well, which was very interesting, actually, that, you know, like, Islam is quite conservative when it comes to, you know, like, sharing a room or a flat with a girl that is not married. So, I mean, that's pretty interesting, right? So we stopped in Jember, and she picked us up, you know, at the station. And she just said, you know, yeah, suddenly I have to go on a business trip to Bali. I cannot host you, unfortunately. So I bought you a one night in a 4-star hotel over there. So I was like, oh my God, I mean, we met just for 5 minutes, and you bought us a hotel. And the hotel was actually just on the street where the carnival was happening. So we just went outside, you know, one night was basically sort of for free. When we wanted to pay for it, she refused. She was angry, you know, like, no, no way. I promised you that, so that's my honor, you know, you cannot do that. And when we went outside, we had this beautiful sight, you know, over here. I sort of felt like during carnival in Rio de Janeiro, let's say, because it was pretty big, and it took many hours, you know, for all the participants to go around with their costumes. Here are other creative costumes, you know, it looked like bones. And yeah, that's about it from Jember. So the carnival itself was not very well organized because it was overcrowded. And apart from that, the costumes themselves were super amazing. So I can highly recommend it in Indonesia as well. Another crazy spontaneous trip. Now, then I went to Bali. Bali is a place where, like, most Czechs go, or tourists. And you know, I didn't expect much, of course, but I was still disappointed because, you know, it's the kind of place which is for vacation, you know. It's like there are just beaches, you know, and lots of tourists. There are just clubs, you know, for tourists to go into. Everything is, you know, like, overcharged. Everybody saw me as the kind of means to earn money, you know. I felt like tourists were just a gold mine. And, you know, after all those local and very friendly experiences I had before, I felt like, you know, the place was a little bit destroyed by tourism. Because, you know, they started to see tourists as something that was usual, and, you know, tourists come and go. So they can behave really badly afterwards, you know, like, and they can ask you for more money, because you will not remember that out of your whole experience. So, I don't want to say, like, the whole Bali is bad, because Bali is a huge place, but, you know, if you stay in touristic places like in Kuta and Ubud, where the monkey forest is located, then expect, you know, like, the lack of authenticity in it, you know, like, you might say, yeah, I was in Indonesia, right? But, I mean, in the end, Indonesia would be just beaches and clubs with internationals. Which, in my opinion, is not a real local experience. I did some hitchhiking in Bali just for fun, because just like in the Philippines, you know, there are no official buses. So the only thing you could do was actually, you know, like hitchhike or pay a lot of money for a taxi in the end. And I hitchhiked for a while. And there were four of us, you know, in front. This picture is a little bit blurry, I'm sorry, but it was super funny because there were four of us in front, and suddenly there were police, you know, going around. And one guy had to hide himself, you know, just below. So, otherwise we would have to pay a really huge fine, and we didn't want that. So I was just making fun of it, you know, like taking picture. So I can definitely recommend hiking in Bali, right? One more thing, I forgot one more thing in Indonesia. It is that there's this new transport coming up that I found. It's called Gojek. And that means that you have this application called Gojek. You can download it, it's for free. And if you go to Jakarta or Bali, those touristic places, then you can just pay 20,000 rupees, which is about 35 crowns, Czech crowns, that's like 1.20 euro. And you can just call yourself a motorcycle driver, and he will take you anywhere within 20 kilometers for this price. So it's definitely cheaper than taxis, and I can definitely recommend it if you are in Indonesia. So in that application, you can just write down, you know, where you are and where you want to go. The driver comes, no questions asked, you give him 20,000, and then you go to that place. And if there are more of you, then you can call more drivers. You know, no problem with that. So that's like a new, finally, some official transport coming up in Indonesia, at least outside big places. All right, let's move to Singapore and Malaysia. I just stayed in the capital of Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur, and you know, the biggest culture shock I had was actually when I went to Singapore, because suddenly there was a civilization, suddenly there was a bus coming, suddenly there were trains, and everything was clean, you know, and everything had its own place on the streets. So this is the kind of place where I felt that even trees were made of wood. That, you know, like there were botanic gardens and everything was quite artificial in a way, you know, everything had its own place. And after that beautiful pristine nature that was there in Java, you know, and the Philippines, I felt sort of like, you know, like in a zoo, that, you know, everything was like prepared for me. So I didn't stay there for long. And in Singapore, what I found very interesting is actually, well, apart from the fact that it's just a concrete jungle, although it might be great for living, no denying that, but there are very strict gambling laws. It's not that I'm a gambler, but you know, it's the kind of thing that's quite typical for Singapore. Is that, you know, when there are foreigners coming in Singapore, they can gamble for free. I mean, you can enter a casino for free and then feel free to gamble. But if you are a local, you have to pay a few thousand crowns, you know, Czech crowns, just to enter, you know, and then maybe you can gamble. So basically, this Singaporean government is trying to discourage people from gambling, from drinking alcohol, and there are very strict fees for smoking on the street and so on. So I felt a little bit like in a police state, because there were cameras all around me, huge fees for every single thing that we consider normal here. And one glass of beer was super expensive, not to mention any harder alcohol. So I mean, it was possible, but the taxes there were really high, and you were quite discouraged, you know, to like drink in restaurants and so on. But of course, in shops, in supermarkets, you could buy some cheaper booze, you know, but it was not that good. Still, those prices were quite high. Right, now I move to Malaysia, but it will be sort of in connection with Singapore a little bit. The thing that is that I experienced the biggest multiculturalism I experienced in my life was in Malaysia and Singapore. The thing is that those countries have four official languages. I mean, there's South Africa, which is even more. But everywhere you go, there are, you know, all the signs must be in four languages. So there's Hindu, there's Malay, there's English, and there's Chinese. Completely different cultures, and all of them cohabiting together, you know, in this city. So this multiculturalism has been there for centuries, and it has deep roots. That's, I guess, why it can work. Because, you know, of course there were some, you know, districts typical for, let's say, Hindus, districts typical for other cultures. But I felt really safe over there, and it was actually a very pleasant experience to see that. In Malaysia, I just stayed for like 5 days or so, and we visited very local markets where we could enjoy, you know, like very local food. But we went to the suburbs, because Kuala Lumpur is again very touristic, and when we visited those markets on the suburbs where there are no foreigners, then this market actually was about 4 kilometers long, and there were just, you know, shops with food and, you know, like souvenirs and so on. And you know, my friends and me, we were like superstars over there. I mean, people were, you know, inviting us again, like for a drink and so on. They wanted to know more about us, because, you know, although it's a huge city, in, you know, Kuala Lumpur is a huge city, Then, you know, once you go outside the center, where they don't see much, many tourists, then they are crazy, you know, about meeting somebody from abroad. So that's something you can definitely enjoy in Asia in general. That's just a typical example from Malaysia, like very strange food. I have no idea how to name it. But the thing is that in Malaysia especially, you could enjoy every single cuisine from Korea, from Japan, from Europe, like all those places were authentic and you could enjoy every single food you can imagine from world. Here's one special thing that happened, again, only through card surfing. In a block of flats where I was staying, there was this huge meeting of my host, and they were discussing segregation of waste. I mean, completely boring and dull topic, right? But I arrived there, I had a great chat with locals, and then there was this durian madness. It was the, durian is a typical fruit for Southeastern Asia. It has a very distinctive flavor, very distinct smell, especially. So there are like, 9 boxes that arrived. That fruit is actually very expensive, and I was lucky enough to enjoy as much durian as I could. So I ate like 2 and I had enough. And you know, those people, they were crazy. I mean, when it arrived, it was for free. Suddenly, like all madness started, and everybody was opening the durians, eating as much as they could. And the smell was really horrible. And that smell from that fruit is actually that horrible that if you take it to the underground, you have to pay, you have to pay some fine for it. That was that crazy, And imagine like those 9 huge boxes with durians, everybody opening, And although we were outside, I felt like, if you just, want to set up some light with matches, there would be like a huge explosion, It felt like a methane, or I don't know how to describe it. Everybody must experience that smell on their own, I think. All right. Another thing that really intrigued me in Malaysia is actually that, this advertisement was all around on taxis. Catch Chilling Spouse, basically your partner. Private investigator and a number over here. And I don't, I have no idea if there's a demand for it in Malaysia. But the whole fact that there are those kind of advertisements around Malaysia, I thought like, oh my God, I guess they have some serious problems, with trust. Because, who would actually hire a private investigator to spy on your spouse, right? On your wife or husband. Very crazy. So that was actually visible on every second taxi you saw. Let's move to Thailand, my last destination, where I stayed just in Chiang Mai and Bangkok. From Bangkok, I had one spontaneous trip to Ayutthaya. I must say, of course, I expected Thailand to be very touristic. But again, the sort of like similar thing that happened in Bali happened also in Thailand. That means that, the authenticity of people was actually destroyed. I mean, they saw tourists as a way to earn money. And every time I went somewhere, they demanded, a lot more money than from a local. And although Thailand has a reputation of a land of smiles, I didn't experience that much. I mean, if I compare the friendliness of Indonesians and the Filipinos, it's something you cannot compare. Maybe it's the fact that I was mostly in touristic places, but in general, I must say that Thailand was a little bit disappointment, although I enjoyed it, but I could see again that the tourism was slowly tearing that place apart, which was a bad thing, of course. And this is like, this conductor was actually, not smiling at me all the time. And when I asked her for a picture, suddenly, a huge change on her face, just for those few seconds. So that's like a small promotion of Thailand. I had the pleasure to spend one afternoon with Buddhist monks, and they taught me a lot about Buddhism in general, and also the Buddhism in its form in northern Thailand. We spent a long chat together, but the thing that I remember the most is that they are basically atheists. I don't mean all Buddhists are atheists, but the ones in northern Thailand. Because they told me, that it's more like a way of living rather than worshipping any god. And although, in Tibet, for example, Buddhism comes from Hinduism, so they have many gods in general. And then, just like we described today, Islam with black magic, then there are many forms, of each religion. So this kind of, course, they presented the local form of the religion or philosophy, and it was a very interesting experience because the monks themselves, they wanted to try English, and they were trying really hard to, you know, like promote the ideas of Buddhism and so on. And I learned a lot from them. It was a very spiritual experience, actually. Then around all those temples, Buddhist temples, there were mostly, you know, like signs telling you more about, you know, the Buddhism, Buddhist philosophy and so on. So to read just something, you know, like nothing is permanent, things come in and go out, detachment is a way to relax, the thing that is liked or disliked just appears, exists for a moment and expires. I cannot hear any God over there. So that's the kind of thing, you know, that I found very interesting, actually. Let's move to another very controversial point in Thailand, which is Tiger Kingdom. I visited Tiger Kingdom only to see the cubs, you know, the small tigers, and I had really good fun doing that. But on the other hand, there are also huge tigers kept in, you know, cages, and every single day there are hundreds of tourists pouring in to, you know, touch the tigers and, you know, take selfies with them and so on. I had a moral dilemma here. Of course, I didn't go inside and do that like all the other tourists, although I paid for the cups, so I mean, I sort of supported it. But the thing is that it didn't feel natural to me. Although those tigers might, you know, grow up in like together with other people, it felt really strange, you know, like it's not how it's supposed to be, in my opinion. And actually, that's not the only case of animal abuse I saw in Thailand. There were also, like, you know, monkeys dressed in suits on the street, and some guys were just earning money, you know, on it. And I felt really bad for it, actually. But it's just supply and demand, because, you know, tourists just go to those places. They actually support those guys, so we should not, you know, blame them for it. They just want to earn money. And that's like one of my many points why I think that Thailand was, you know, is getting destroyed by tourism in a way. Right. Good. Let's move to Bangkok, my last destination. In Bangkok, I had the pleasure to try some very crazy food, like scorpions, cockroaches, lizards, and worms, and so on. As I'm really crazy, I always go into, you know, like duck embryos and live octopus and so on. I guess there's nothing else can surprise me now. So that was a very nice experience, actually. And the last but not least, in Bangkok, you know, Bangkok is a famous place for prostitution, right? And as we discussed, I mean, the demand comes from tourists again. If you go to the center of Bangkok, you can see mostly, you know, like older, like middle-aged European guys, single, you know, traveling alone, looking for some cheap prostitutes. So again, I had like my moral compass was suffering, you know, seeing that all the time. And that comes, you know, during the daylight and also during the night. Of course, I visited some strip club, you know, to see it like the first hand. I didn't do anything else, you know. But once I went outside, I could see just tourists again. And only locals that were there, especially guys, the only thing they were doing, they were actually supporting it by having taxis around, so they can actually, you know, bring you to their hotels, you know, and so on. And some guys selling food and drugs, you know, on the street. So again, like locals were also helping that because they wanted to earn a lot more money, right? But after all, you know, this kind of reputation is earned only because of tourism. You know, of course, there must be some local places for prostitution, but it would never reach this kind of height without tourists. So, you know, all in all, I enjoyed Thailand, of course, but I just wanted to pinpoint some striking differences. And yeah, I think that I've come to the end. And let's remember that every single journey begins with a single step. So I want to wish you good luck on your next journey, and I hope that I motivated you to travel solo as first, and try to meet locals when you travel. Thank you very much for your attention. As I advertised on the Facebook event, I needed around 250 crowns per day. I actually spent, I had 90,000 crowns in my pocket, you know. For the airline, or like for the flight tickets, I had to pay 30,000 because I had around 15 flight tickets, and therefore I had 60,000. When I came back home, I had 10,000 in my pocket. So in 3 months, it cost me 50,000, something like that. So, and it's because I didn't, you know, pay for the accommodation at all. Apart from one time I spent in a capsule hostel in Japan. So that's like, you know, the place where you sleep in a casket, you know, it's good fun. I recommend it for one night. And it, basically just my expenses, apart from the flight tickets, it was 50,000 crowns. Which, you know, if I count it well, I'm planning to leave for a year and a half next year. And I will need about $250,000, I think, to survive for a year and a half. But yeah, we will see. It's very kind of more than less. Is there any question? Any other question? You can ask me, you know, like without the microphone, and then I'll repeat it in English. Yeah?
What was your favorite food that you experienced?
Korean food. Yes. Korean food was like number one, and I love going to Korean pubs or like restaurants over here. Japanese food was perfect as well, but you get fed up very easily. You know, I was there for like 2 weeks and eating sushi, you know, all the time, and no soups. I didn't feel full, you know, afterwards. It's always like small dishes, small courses, you know, like many courses, and after a while eating raw fish all the time, it didn't do well to my Czech stomach, you know, since we had no sea. Right? Good, so basically Korean food was perfect, Malaysian food was also good, but very, very spicy. And Filipino food is basically American food, sort of like, you know, almost all Filipinos eat in chains, you know, fast food chains, so you can see a lot of McDonald's and so on. But on the other hand, they have their own chain, you know, like fast food chain, it's called Jollibee's. And it was an amazing, you know, thing to try, because it's just in the Philippines and Hong Kong or Singapore, I think. That's it. Right. Any other question? If I've ever encountered any problems on my journey, good. I must say that, you know, I've been traveling since I was 18. I haven't had almost any problems on, like, ever. The biggest problems I've had in my life, I'll tell you, like, the most dangerous ones I've had, you know? It was in Turkey, 2014, when one of my hosts from Couchsurfing wanted to buy some wheat, which is pretty difficult in Muslim countries. So we went to this very dangerous district in Istanbul, and over there I saw those little Salafist guys, you know, with beards, and I felt like, you know, like a bullet can always end up in my back. So that was not a very pleasant experience to move around there, go into some strange warehouse and get some wheat, you know, for that host. So that was like one of the most dangerous experiences I've had. Then. In Georgia, in 2014 again, I had to book a hostel because it was pretty difficult to find couchsurfing in Georgia, Gruzia, in Czech. And when I arrived to the address of the hostel, there was nothing. I mean, there was just like a house, empty windows, you know, that's it. So it was around 10 p.m., you know, and it was very dark, and I was just stranded on the street. And, you know, I just had to go to the nearest place, you know, and I had to pay some money, you know, so really a lot of money, actually, for just one night. And concerning this Asian trip, the only bad thing that happened to me on this trip was actually that my phone was stolen in the Philippines, but it was mostly because of my own stupidity. When I was sitting in the taxi, I sat down and, you know, the phone slipped away from my pocket, basically. And, you know, I was in the taxi, and the taxi driver left, you know, and I went out, and I told him, the doors were still open, you know, and I told him, can you please stop? I mean, I forgot my phone, and I was, like, leaning there, you know, for it, and, you know, he just put the full throttle and he left, you know, with my phone. So that was pretty problematic to organize my couchsurfing stuff, because you really need, the internet all the time. You need to stay all night if you want to travel like this. And to organize, you know, your next host and where to stay and so on. But apart from this experience, I must say that I have been very lucky, you know, so far. So I hope that nothing bad will happen in the future. So yeah, no guts, no glory, let's say.
Any other questions? question.
Did you get vaccinated before the trip, and if so?
Perfect question. There are about 6 recommended vaccinations to go to Southeastern Asia, but that's basically no vaccinations for any place. The vaccination I got, actually I just told myself, you know, you can get hepatitis, or I don't know how it's called in English, something like that. And I just said, yeah, damn it, you know, I can just use normal prevention, right? I mean, I can wash my hands, I can pay attention to what I eat, that, you know, like many people grabbed and so on. And I just got like one against typhus, or I don't know how it's called in English. I got this one. And otherwise, you know, it might be a good investment if you plan to travel for a long time, for sure, because it lasts for ages, right? I mean, most of the vaccinations. But the one I was really scared about was malaria. And the thing is that there's no vaccination against malaria. You can only take some, you know, medications when you are there. And as far as I heard, it influences your psyche a little bit, and it's pretty dangerous to do that. And so the thing I did, I bought like a super strong repellent, you know, for mosquitoes. And you can imagine me, you know, like when we were in the jungle going to visit the tribe, we had to cross some rivers, you know. So I was like up here, I was in a river, then I went out and all the repellent was off, you know. So I had to always do it again and again, you know. And I felt really scared there. I mean, just one bite and you can get a malaria, right? Which would be very, very, very bad on my journey. I don't know how I would actually solve that. I mean, I was insured, of course, but imagine getting malaria on the way in some village, you know, that would be pretty bad. So, I mean, most of those vaccinations that are recommended, I think they can, those illnesses can be avoided by normal prevention, you know, just pay attention to what you eat. But if you want to stay safe, I mean, you can always invest the money. It's not such a problem, right? So basically, I just risked it. Like, I had only 1 out of 6. Yeah. Is there any other question?
Yeah. Did you manage all these countries in one summer?
Yes, I did. If I don't count Malaysia and Singapore, I stayed in each country for, in average, for about 2 weeks. And, you know, as a student, I was earning money on my own for throughout the whole year. I saved enough money and then I left just when I finished my last exam. I left until the beginning of the next semester. And I was gone for like 3 months, which is exactly the time, the free time you have if you manage to do like most of your exams in time. So for students, that's like the best way, I guess. I mean, if you don't want to lose any, if you don't want to have any gap year. So right now, you know, I'm sacrificing this summer. I'm staying here after 6 years, probably, during summer. And I work, I'll save a lot of money. And probably, hopefully I can leave after finishing school. So that means being gone for like a year and a half, and then probably working abroad as a teacher of English. I'll try my best. So, yeah. So you can actually make it in 3 months. And you saw how many crazy experiences you can have in 3 months. I mean, it's entirely up to your way of traveling. You know, you can just lock yourself up in a hotel, being on a beach, or you can just, you know, sacrifice your comfort zone, let's say, and you can just be spontaneous and crazy, meet strangers through couchsurfing, and then, you know, like go to and have a lot of spontaneous parties, a lot of spontaneous trips, and so on. So, but, you know, it's the kind of thing that doesn't come immediately, you know, that's why I actually mentioned from the very beginning that it's good to start slowly, you know, like taking work camps, you know, before and after your first work camp, you can try couchsurfing for a few days, you will just see how it works, and if you like it, and then you can slowly, you know, push the bar up. Like, it was my first time traveling for such a long time. Every time before, it was like, 1 month, then 2 months, suddenly 3 months, and suddenly, you know, like 3 months don't feel enough. I want to leave for a very long time. So it's the thing that you need to push the bar up. Otherwise, you know, you cannot just start from the end. It's better to, you know, have like a few short trips before you leave, like on a very crazy spontaneous trip, like my guest over here. Because, you know, he actually told me today that he has no fixed plan and no fixed time of coming back, which is crazy. I mean, that's amazing. I really admire you for that. That's cool. You want to mention something about it, maybe? Like, because you can inspire people as well, actually. Would you like to do that? I mean, just tell us something about your plan. How long have you been traveling, and why are you using Couchsurfing? And also, when are you coming back, probably?
Well, I sort of started traveling, like you mentioned something about doing incremental steps. So I did a 3-month voluntary experience in India. And before that, I'd worked abroad in Paris and then gone to the Canaries with friends and obviously done various different little weekend trips away. So it really does build up. And did you ever participate in woofing? Woofing's really
Yeah, I've heard about it, but I'm not trying to do that.
But couchsurfing is, to me, it's more of a sort of a cultural exchange rather than just getting free accommodation. So
yeah, this is just a like cycle.
Yeah, absolutely. And my last guests here in Prague, they were a Romanian family, and they had a wonderful family who were teaching the kids some English and that kind of thing. So basically, I'm backpacking from Sheffield to Bali, but I'm not flying. So just basically going across Europe, then Armenia, then Georgia, and then across Russia, which is going to take a while. But I only have a 30-day visa, so it's still pretty quick. Then Mongolia, China, Vietnam, Cambodia. Cambodia, Laos, Thailand, Malaysia,
then
Singapore.
Then just take a ferry.
Yeah.
How long do you think it will take you?
I get that question a lot, and I really. How
so
long is it going to
be free? Yeah? You can leave for as long as you want.
Yeah, pretty much. It's. I worked for 2 years to be able to try and afford this, I guess. But
2 years?
Yeah.
So basically, you just have some limited budget, then you will go as long as your budget allows.
Yeah, but hopefully, when I get past Europe, it will be a lot less expensive, and there'll be more opportunities to work in more rural parts and reconnect with communities. When I get to Mongolia, for instance, I really want to try to. Sounds crazy to find some Mongol or some nomadic peoples to try and just hang around with. My host in
Ulaanbaatar.
Sorry?
Capital of Mongolia.
Oh, right, yeah. Just try and get out of the cities mainly. Because my friend
was
based
in this spot.
Hanover? Yeah, Hanover. She said always go to the places that you don't really fancy going, because that's where the most fun and crazy experiences that you all remember happen.
Yeah, especially.
You feel like
because you know they appreciate tourists coming.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Go to the places.
They have completely different approach towards you, right? Like in that Philippine village which we discussed, right? When you arrive with a girl from Africa, suddenly the world and the world stops. You know, and the world starts to revolve around you, basically. Mm. Right. Yeah, that's really interesting and inspirational. I really appreciate that, because I plan to do very similar thing very soon. But probably going from Las Vegas to South America, probably like south of Argentina or something.
Wow, good.
And then who knows where I end up. I will try my best to, this summer I'm doing a course to become a certified teacher so I can teach abroad. And who knows if I find a job in South Africa. That's one of my dream places for now. And maybe New Zealand, who knows? No idea. So it will be very spontaneous. You never know.
I find a lot of fun in trying to find the sort of interesting places. For instance, I went to Amsterdam and I was determined to try and find a part of Amsterdam that didn't orienteer around green leaves and red lights.
Yeah.
And it was a case of my couchsurfing host was a Syrian refugee living in Amsterdam, and he was vegan. I'm vegetarian, so Asia's going to be difficult, I'm sorry.
Yeah, you will.
But we'll work it out. And this guy just opened sort of my world into this. I didn't expect anything, and he made this whole feast type thing, this vegan meal, and it was just an incredible exchange type thing.
Actually, you know, I've met many vegetarians.
you know, like traveling.
Yeah.
And every time they asked for something vegetarian in Asian, you know, places, they were always crazy. They were like, why would you not eat meat? You know, they consider it like, you know, like a deviation or something. You know, to be vegetarian.
Sometimes it's just easy to say like you're allergic.
Oh yeah, true. Yeah, true.
Just not.
But then you know, like, then they cook it with meat, for example, and they just put it away afterwards. You know, they like sort it out.
The strangest experience with meat I had was in Tamil Nadu in India when I was volunteering.
Yeah.
I was sat across from a guy that was Indian, Hindu, and he was eating a beef curry. And this is the most strange contradiction I've ever had.
Since in India it's strictly forbidden to eat meat, right?
It is. But
it's sort of like eating pork in Muslim countries. It's like sort of like eating pork in Muslim countries, right? It's, would you compare it? Sort of?
But it's open to interpretation. So.
Yeah. Yeah, but you know, there's a big difference that, you know, like Muslim countries see it as a filthy meat.
Yeah.
To eat pork. But on the other hand, in India, it's said to be sacred, yes. Right? That's the opposite approach. But also strictly from the end. Yeah. Any other questions? For me or for our friend here? Yeah?
Any issues with the hygiene of food or something?
Hygiene of food?
You mean if I had some diarrhea or something? Right. Only once, and it happened when we were and scuba diving around the Philippines, and it happened to me on a desolate island with no people, and I experienced it as like a tribal. You know, I had to use like palm leaves for it. So that was a very funny experience like that. But in general, I must say that, you know, I expected it to be much worse, since I always was trying, you know, like local food, and I didn't have that many problems, actually, lucky enough.
Right.
But, you know, I guess it depends on the person and how strong your stomach is, because, you know, my brother, for example, when he went to Turkey, he tried some chocolate cake, and he had diarrhea from this already. So that depends, you know, on the person, I think. You know, you should know your body, yourself, and then, you know, take the steps, you know, so that you don't become sick. All right.
Okay, any other question?
Well, either you or your observing host set up a website, or have any YouTube videos being posted, or is a blog being written, and you just do once a month on your trips? Either, yeah.
You mean like if you want to set up a blog or something?
Like how can we follow you? You're doing. Will you guys be posting anything?
You guys start. No, you. You are very good.
I literally just started one. Well, I started when I set out in February. But like I said, I commit to 2 posts per month, and it's incredibly difficult to even do that because you're like a sponge when you're traveling. You're always going
exactly.
You don't want to be in front of the computer all day.
Exactly.
Unless you enjoy that.
I have to show you one thing. You know, when I travel, I'm a very lazy person, you know, in general. I mean, although I work a lot, but then when I travel, I just want to enjoy everything to the full. And I would find it actually quite difficult to sustain any blog. But on the other hand, I have a diary. I can show you just what it looks like over here. And you know, I write every single experience and my feeling towards that experience, so it's rather personal, you know. But I can just show you, you know, like what it looks like when it's just minimized, like this. You know, like that's my diary over here. It has about 150 pages in A4, and you know, I have it like a book, sort of, you know, on my phone. And every time I take the underground, you know, to work, I always, you know, I have like chapters over there according to town, you know, and date. And I always read like a certain chapter, and I always, you know, have everything in front of my eyes. And I started in 2014. And you know, it's much better than the videos I actually shot, because like the ones that are on the event wall, they are really long, you know, like each is on average like 20 minutes. But you know, this diary, that will be something, you know, that I'll cherish for the rest of my life. And you know, if I travel for a year and a half, and if I keep the same pace, it will be around 1,000 pages of A4. My God, I mean, if I decide, you know, like, to publish it. Of course, I will need to, you know, put some filter on it, which will probably take like half of it away. But you know, if I do it, it will take it will be a huge book. So it's personal, and you know, if I want to put it on blog, then I would have to, you know, like cut some, you know, pieces from it. but I'm too lazy to do that. Maybe, you know, I can do it afterwards when I come back. But, you know, keeping the blog for other people is like, you know, taking too many pictures. It's not, you know, you stop enjoying the moment, and after a while you just stop for a few days just to write your thoughts, which is better to put on diary. But on the other hand, you know, those people, they sacrifice, you know, for the pleasure of other people. But in my opinion, you know, like, that's what I'm doing right now, is that when I have a free time, I actually try to inspire people to go out and experience it on their own. Because I guess there are just too many people attending, you know, all of these lectures. They even pay money for it, you know, most of the times. And then they ask, you know, how come I cannot save enough money for traveling? So actually, you know, I would actually just, I want to promote this whole idea so they experience it on their own. So they don't, you know, stay in dreams. But, you know, on the other hand, it's just, you know, it's helpful. But there are dozens of those books, you know, you can read any books.
If you want to follow my blog, maybe.
So, I mean, I admire people who do that. I hope they will keep up, but I'm not that kind of person. That's all. Any other question? Anybody? Yeah?
Do you know what other kind of works? You said we will need to write it?
You had some experience from India, right?
That was like a government-funded program. So it was funded by the Department for International Development. And basically that was it was a youth organization called Restless Development. It was like the partnering organization of the International Citizen Service. So it sounds like a really complex web. But there are places out there, I'm sure there'll be like a government program for just about any country that's funding overseas aid or
point.
Yeah, that's volunteerism, not volunteering. So
For this thing, there's EVS, European Voluntary Service,
yes.
But it's mostly like, you know, long term, at least 3 months. Mm-hmm. And actually, you get some pocket money, if I'm not mistaken. And you might even save some money for me, I'm not sure. But yeah, take advantage of it as long as you can. It's called EBS. That's the, I've never experienced this project, but I heard about it. And actually the link I you know mentioned that like next is the RCZ for webcams. You can see it there too. They offer it. You know, it's like they have short term I don't have the internet here, I cannot show you. But they have the short-term projects and the long-term projects over there. And you can take some project for, you know, 1 month or 3 months or a year. It's up to you. Here's the link. The next is the it's for checks and small bags.
But this is only for check?
Unfortunately, yeah. It's the selling organization of our country.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, each country has the different selling organizations. And you know, like, for the administration fee, you just pay, like, you know, I think, like, 3,000, something like that, if I remember. I mean, it's been a long time, but it's not that much money in the end.
I was completely free, but I think you can as an international volunteer with International Citizen Service UK, but I think you have to fund your travel to the UK, like you have to do a selection interview, and then your pre-departure training, and then you obviously have your placement, but they pay for everything up until you get to the UK. Mm. Yeah, you have to pay to get to the UK.
Most of the times you need to pay for the travel expenses and pay some administration fee. But you know, if you count like all the things that you do there, and if you were to do it in your home, you would spend like, you know, five times as much. So in the end, you know, it's still worth it. You know, it's, you know, like nothing comes for free. There's no such thing as free lunch. You know, so in the end, you still need to pay for it some amount. Any other question?
I have a question about the weather, actually, because I know the summer is the rainy season, and if you experience a lot of rain.
Actually, there was a problem that, you know, especially in Palawan, there is this rain season, you know, and summer season is also in Bangkok and so on. I was lucky enough when I arrived in Palawan in El Nido. I stayed there for like 6 days, and out of those 6 days, three days were, it was raining. So I was, you know, like cooking with locals and doing, you know, like things you can do indoors. The thing is, it shouldn't discourage you. That's the first thing that I want to mention. If you are going during the rainy season, then plan for a longer period of time. Because the rainy season is not the thing that it rains straight, you know, like for a week or so. It is the kind of rainfalls that are very heavy and take only like, you know, 20 minutes, then it's okay for 1 hour, and again, 20 minutes. And then, you know, I wouldn't you know, be discouraged by this fact, because if you want to stay somewhere where the weather really matters, like, you know, scuba diving or island hopping, whatever, then you can just, you know, reserve more time for the activity. So stay there for longer. And if you see that, you know, yeah, the weather is great, we did everything we wanted in 3-4 days, then you can just leave sooner, or you can stay longer. So it's something that I would advise to be discouraged about. I mean, it is bad, of course, when it happens. But all in all, I don't care if I go in rainy season or summer season, because it's still very hot. You know, no matter when you go. Okay. Any other question?
Do you remember some of the either websites you found flights or even some of the
great question.
Airlines?
Yeah, I use Skyscanner, which is like you know, alpha omega, let's say, of everything, of all those, you know, flight tickets. And then there's called one called Delta Trip, which offers you deltatrip.com, if I'm not mistaken, but it's easy to find, and it gives you the alternative routes. So, you know, to give you an example, let's say I want to fly very cheaply from Prague to Istanbul, let's say. And this is just very hypothetical this time. But Delta Trip would actually ask you, what is the, you know, like the radius that we should look around, you know? And then they see, yeah, there's one flight from Brno, actually, you know, flying to Izmir. And it's like, you know, 1/10 of the price. So it gives you like this alternative way you can take for a fraction of that price, and let's say you say you can save a lot of money, but you will not save time, because you need to travel to those small towns and take the transport to your favorable destination. So that's just one other way you can do. But Skyscanner is like the most important one, of course. Yeah. And for Czechs, there's definitely the website is in Czech, but I mean it might be used by foreigners as well. And it gives you tips on some special deals on flight tickets. It's called akcinileteky.com.
Also, Pelikan?
Pelikan, yeah, exactly. Most of the times, like on the website I mentioned, sometimes they like give the promo, you know, and some deals from Pelikan. So Pelikan is definitely one good ones as well. Yeah? I've never tried it on my own, I know it exists. You can find a lot of literature on travel hacking, you know, like how to find even flights for free. I've even seen like a Ryanair flight where you pay zero and then you just pay for the baggage. And it was like flight from Poland to London or somewhere like that, you know. So there are ways, definitely, you can find them. And you know, I try it from my own experience and I ask around. But if you are interested, you can just look for some literature on travel hacking, is the term, you know. So if you type like travel hacking, you might probably find a lot of good tips. Travel hacking, you know, like hacking a computer. So yeah, that's definitely worth it, worth your time, probably. Any other question?
What about visas?
In Asia, I didn't need any visa for the countries I visited, as a Czech, I mean. I was lucky enough because in Indonesia they changed the policy just the year I was going there, and like 2 weeks before I went there I didn't need any visa. They changed it for like 30 days for free. Otherwise you need to pay upon the arrival. I don't know, it was around 500 Czech crowns, so it wasn't that bad. We have to consider the fact that for us Czechs or people from Europe, it's very easy to travel. I mean, most of the countries are open for us, even without visa. And, you know, when I'm planning to go like from Vegas, you know, to South America, I don't need a visa anywhere. like all Central America, Mexico, America. I don't need it, but I will need to, you know, be in database, you know, I need to fill in some forms, but in the end I don't pay anything. Maybe it will change by the time I go. But you know, all Central America, nothing, all Southern America, nothing, you know. You can just come with your passport, that's it. So for us it's super easy. That's something I felt very bad about the Philippines, because those people are open to everybody. I mean, everybody can come. But if Filipinos want to travel, the first thing is that their salaries are really low, as well as the prices, and then they have to pay for visa even for like also neighboring countries. If they want to go to Japan, they have to pay for visa. If they want to go to, let's say, Thailand, probably not, but let's say if they want to go to Indonesia, then they probably have to pay for visa.
Do you buy any souvenirs or something to bring from these?
Yeah, I have this kind of policy that I try not to buy souvenirs because I mostly get them from locals. For example, when I was having this feast and this dinner with those tribes in Taiwan, they gave me this beautiful stone that they have found in the park, because you know, this kind of stone, it's called the rose stone, you know, it's pink. And it's, let's say, mined only in that region, in that part, and it's very valuable, actually. And of course you can buy it there, you know, but they gave the one that they found, you know. And then other souvenirs are, I don't know, like a poem, you know, written by my friend, or the Japanese grandparents that I stayed with. They wrote me a kind of letter in Japanese and with hand-drawn, you know, pictures. So those are the kind of souvenirs I mostly have. And of course, I buy souvenirs for my closest friends and for my family. But most of the times I buy for them, but you know, I hardly ever have any souvenirs. Souvenirs, my souvenir was that diary that you saw. That's my souvenir. Yeah, but of course it's good to buy them in general, yeah. Most of the times I get the souvenirs from hosts, they are really kind. Another good souvenir, actually, I can show you, just...
I always have it with me, you know, it's the... this. I have this on my back, and this was given to me by one of the tribals, and it's this ceremony, you know, like a knife for ceremonies, you know. It is a miniature version, you know? It's like, it's not the live version, but it's for opening letters, you know. And it looks exactly like the ceremonial knife they used. So that's the kind of thing, you know, they made it there. And I couldn't buy it anywhere, this kind of thing. So those are the things I cherish the most. But of course, souvenirs are really important when you travel. If you want, especially postcards, if you want, like, want to keep that memory. Yeah. So I can definitely, you know, like, it's up to everyone. That's it. Any other question?
Did you do any research on like a travel scam before you went to some of these places? Like what to avoid or what to look out for?
You know, when you use cards for train, you are with locals. So most of the times they know which places not to go to and which places to avoid and so on. Before I go there, I mean, the first thing I check is like, you know, economic situation, religion, political situation as well. And then, you know, like warnings, like official warnings of our government. If I'm not, you know, like supposed to go, let's say, to Afghanistan, you know, for example, you know. So those are the kind of checks I do. Then I check the travel blogs. But it's not the kind of travel blog that tells you, like, what the experience was, but just the kind of points that the guy emphasizes on his trip. Like Batak tribe. I even asked locals, they didn't know about it. And one Korean traveler of my age just, you know, wrote a short article on it, and I just gave it a shot, you know. So yeah, that was... it's definitely worth doing your research so that you are not completely surprised. I mean, most of the times you will discover many new things when you arrive. But the most crucial things you should do before, definitely. And the best way to do it is the internet, because it's always updated. You know, if you buy some books for it, then from 2014, then, you know, in 2016 the situation might be different and you get shot, for example, somewhere, you know. Like, let's say, if you buy some Syria 2010, you know, then you go to Syria, you don't check anything, you know, although it's everywhere. But then, you know, suddenly you realize, yeah, there's a war, you know, so something like that. It's definitely better to double check on the internet, everything. Any other question?
Yeah. FCO, which stands for Foreign Commonwealth Office. And basically, it's just the UK government's outlook on cultural affairs. It talks on our requirements for visas. Yeah, it's worth checking out.
FCO.uk or
yes, FCO.co.uk.
Gov.uk,
sorry.
Gov.uk.
And obviously, it might differ from country to country depending on your nationality or where you're from.
Yeah, sometimes I think I've seen it once and there was a warning about some country, you know, like where not to go to.
Yeah, so. I mean, it's handy, but I got fed up with researching in the end.
After a while,
you know what, I'm getting so many different points of view, so many conflicting arguments. Oh, don't go to Tibet in China, you'll never get there, you'll never be allowed on this guy actually walking there. It was easy. You know, there's so many conflicting stories online.
Yeah.
You just have to get out there and see the world through your own eyes rather than others.
Like, just remember the warnings I got from Filipinos themselves about the slum. You know, like, how could you go to Smoky Mountain, you know, like that, you know? You're, at first, you're not a local, and you look rich to them, you know? Like, they will kill you over there. And I was completely fine. They even appreciated me going there, giving and distributing food, you know, like that. So sometimes you just, have some self-preservation, you know, of course, this reflects, but sometimes just go for the unknown, you know. Most of the times you will not regret that. Any other question, or should we just add anything?
Can I add something? Just add some.
Of course. Yeah.
You know, some places you have the gut feeling you shouldn't go there. Don't do it.
If you have a good feeling about it.
The gut feeling.
I've got
places you have to go through. Then you'll be fine.
So let's say if you have this intuition and you see that, you know, this place might be, then it might be.
Yes.
Then, yeah. Let's say.
And sometimes you might. This is going to be the best, and usually it is. I mean,
yeah, exactly. Like some minor speeds in Manila. Actually, it was more dangerous in the center, in the rich center in Manila, than in those slums. Because, you know, like if I went to some minor street over there, something bad might have happened. Like, actually, the only guy that robbed me was some rich taxi driver in the center. You know, robbed me of my cell phone. And, you know, that surprised me, actually, quite a lot.
Really?
Well, sort of. I mean, of course. Yeah, I mean, but, you know, when I went to Manila, I expected more to be robbed by poor people rather than rich ones. Which is ironic, right?
You are the most generous people.
Yeah.
Not the most.
Sure. We'll agree more. Any other questions then?
What about the money? I mean, did you keep all those money cash or did you use AMT?
Yeah, the thing I did is that I have 1 euro for free every month when I'm abroad, anywhere. One euro for free, then you pay 5%, I think, of the amount you take. And when I arrived in Japan, I withdrew about 10,000 Czech crowns, something like that. And then I put it in different places, you know, like in my backpack and so on. I mostly tried to have, you know, like just the amount I needed. And then I actually tried to use my debit card everywhere I could. And, you know, if you go like to civilized places, so to say, then, you know, it's possible to play with your card anywhere. And you don't have to pay any extra fees for that. So, but then there are places where you must have cash and there are no ATMs, like villages in the Philippines, Iran, for example, you know, like the places where you need to have cash, otherwise you are doomed, definitely. And try not to have all your cash in one place, definitely, and try to withdraw just what you think you need for that month. But then it's up to you, then you can withdraw again with 5%, you know. I mean, it's not such a huge tragedy in the end. Yeah. Any other question?
Did you try to line up like backup cop service in case your original cop service sort of fell through, or did you join any last minute cop serving, you know, this city or this groups?
Great question, because it actually happened on the way in Taiwan when I was waiting for one guy. He didn't show up. And I always try my best That's why open requests are even better than direct requests, because you get invitations, and then you say, yeah, I'm staying with one guy, and then, you know, you can exchange contact, and you can always contact some other people, you know, if the first person actually fails you, you know. And it really does happen, yeah. But then again, you know, don't forget to pay attention, good attention to negative references and neutral references as well. Because the typical neutral reference would be the guy didn't show up. That's the typical neutral reference. Negative reference would be the guy tried to drug me and rape me. That's the kind of negative reference. Yeah. So I mean, pay attention to those things. Any other question? I actually mentioned it. It was in Iceland. The guy, we exchanged just a few, you know, phrases, and I had zero reference, and he trusted me. And when I arrived, he left the keys in the post box. That's why I mentioned it's like one of the craziest experiences from couchsurfing. It was my first one. Yeah. And yeah, I found that idea only because of my brother. You know, he's 6 years older, so I mean, he has struggled a bit. Now I exceeded that, but I mean, he gave me the first good tips, and I had like the best tip already when I was 16, you know, like on what to do, how to travel, which helped me definitely. And it's definitely at first to have a good plan B and to have the couchsurfing spirit. That means, you know, like you trust the people, because you yourself, you are very positive, right? You have positive thinking, you don't want to do harm, and you believe that other people around you are the same. And like, I must say that I've never had any really like super bad experience on the couchsurfing. The worst one was that the host didn't show up, which is still okay. And, you know, if you have this kind of good thinking, positive thinking, then you attract the positive people as well, I think. So, yeah, just relying on the references and your gut feeling, like the guy over there said. Yeah, so your gut feeling, you know, like if you feel bad about a person, the way he reacts, that he writes like short sentences, you know, like weird, kind of ambiguous things, you know, especially when you're a woman, then yeah, I mean, pay good attention to it, yeah. Then, you know, you can try traveling with someone afterwards, that's definitely safer, but if you travel solo, it's more, or let's say it's easier to be hosted afterwards, you know, when you are more, then I cannot host more than one person here in Prague, you know? Or even if I could, probably, I would feel bad about not paying proper attention to both of them. I mean, one of them would probably just go out and, you know, I wouldn't host properly. It would be just a free hostel in the end. So, most of the times you are much luckier, you know, if you are just alone traveling rather than with someone. But, you know, as a couple, for example, it works pretty well as well. In some countries. I mean, there are countries where couchsurfing has no basis, and Georgia is a typical good example, actually. In Georgia, I encountered the problem that all the couchsurfers there, there are not many, that's the first thing. There are not many couchsurfers in Georgia, and all of them couldn't speak English. I mean, it was difficult to find anyone. All of them just could speak Georgian and Russian, and the same problem was on the street. And I was just lucky enough to have good friends from volunteer projects. So they, you know, like, helped me out a lot, you know, like, I stayed with Georgian family, actually, you know, during that time, it was, like, really good. But I could do that only because that guy was really educated, you know, and, like, he traveled a lot, that's why. So, in general, like, if you use couchsurfing for this, let's say, in certain countries, it doesn't work really well. But, let's say, in most countries, it does work really well. Fortunately, the majority are really good. Yeah, true. Always check your groups. Yeah.
I was in Belgium, and I was going to on my way to Luxembourg, and I ended up getting a ride to Luxembourg.
Yeah.
And the only guys that made a public request, what's it called?
Yeah, public request.
Yeah, public trip request or whatever it's called. And the only guys that were messaging me saying, yeah, well, I can host you, just check my profile to make sure you understand. And it is very important that you read absolutely everything on the profile. If you go down and oh, this guy seems nice. Mm. Genuinely, he's got photos of people who seem like that, good time. He's filled his profile out correctly, and he's got this.
Yeah.
Oh, groups. This guy is part of a naturist group. does that mean if I stay at your house, I am also expected to be an actress? And he said, yes, and I only host male guests. And I'm like, that's your philosophy. I'm vegetarian, but I don't force vegetables down your throat, so don't force meat down my throat.
I definitely agree, actually. I have that kind of experience on Couchsurfing too. But it's the kind of thing that those freaks, they always get themselves in, you know? Like, they, in the very first message, they always reveal it, you know, in a way. That, you know, you can see that. I will give you some examples. I had open request in Antalya, in Turkey. The response I got, I can be your sex guide in Antalya. My 40-year-old single guy. You know, terrible. I mean, I just reported that. Then in Belgium, that's quite funny, that happened in Belgium too. I got a response by some couple, around 40-year-olds, and they told me like we are very open-minded, you know, and you can come and enjoy, let's say. So it was very weird, I mean, what the hell? Of course, zero references, new members, you know, probably freshly deleted, you know. So yeah, terrible. And once I also got a message from one guy, can't remember from where, and he told me like, yeah, I can stay, but you have to share the bed with me, you know, like, and he sent me the picture like of a, you know, beautifully arranged bed, you know, like, as if from like some fairy tale or whatever, you know. But I said like, oh my god, no thanks. Yeah, so I mean, in my opinion, like, those people usually like they reveal it quite directly at the beginning. They have like different intentions. And when I was traveling in Hungary in 2014. I would just, you know, use open request, and I got some message, you know, like an automatic message from Couchsurfing. There was like a picture of one guy, and they wrote, this guy was dragging girls and raping them, you know, like, what the hell? And it was like, if you see this guy with this picture or with similar guy, never, you know, like, accept his, you know, like, their invitations. Because, you know, Couchsurfing, there's no authority on Couchsurfing, it's just a web, it's made by people. So, you know, if you get, you know, really bad experience to Couchsurfing, you cannot just come to like Couchsurfing webmasters and say, you know, like, I had a very bad experience, you know, and I need to pay me back or whatever, you know. So it's something you always need to deal with, you know, in the place, with the police, if something bad really happens. And I have met many people who have had really bad experience with Couchsurfing, so. Yeah, the best you can do is just take a look at the references and that's it, you know, like, yeah, and gut feeling.
I would say prepared as well, when you check the references, just check if it's mainly girls or boys, because the first time I used Couchsurfing, I found someone in Berlin, and he was a boy, and he was really friendly, so I heard that he was okay, and when I checked the references, I didn't pay attention if it was only girls. And after that, he started sending these messages and said, oh, I will be busy, but you know, you look very cute, so I'm sure you'll find a way, painting eye and stuff like that. And so I started wondering, asking the question, and then I went to the references, so that it was only mainly girls that were there. So just pay attention when you look at it, even if the guy is friendly, just look for it.
Trust me.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I found someone like the day just after someone else, so it's really nothing bad. But
yeah.
Don't be scared to
be
something.
Let's say I've had total like 200 experiences on Couchsurfing. I have to say that, you know, it happened once that you know, like, something, you know, more came out of it. But I mean, if it comes in a natural way, you know, like, that it's not something planned from the very beginning. If like both sides, you know, are okay with that, and it comes as a normal kind of dating, you know, then it's, I think it's okay. But it's not the kind of thing you should like enter Couchsurfing with.
It's not Tinder.
Exactly. Yeah.
Exactly. So I mean, the primary objective is not that. Yeah. It's the cultural exchange, the body fluid exchange. All right. Well,
sorry.
One guy in Belgium offered to pay me to change my body if I'd
stay. So you see, there are a lot of weirdos on Couchsurfing. Just pay attention, you know, like, pay good attention to references. You know, check the, you know, really strange signs from the other part, and you know,
that's the most you can do. You can always leave afterwards, you know. It always starts, you know, like slowly, you know, and you see some signs at first. And if you have like this bad gut feeling about it, then you should always go to a different host place then. Yeah. Any other question? But I think we should finish it very soon. Let's say last question, I don't know. Does anybody have a question?
What company or website did you use for your travel insurance? Do you recommend one or just kind of do your own research?
I use the calculator. That's like the one that, you know, I studied for how long I want to travel. And they calculated and they compared about 10 insurance companies, and I took the one that was the cheapest, providing me with you know, the most benefits. And I was lucky enough not to be involved in any accidents, so I didn't need it. But let's say for those 90 days, I paid around 3,000, something like that, for those 3 months. I heard, but I forgot about it, you know, during my last lecture, like 1 month ago, I had, then there was one guy who told me about some Alpena, something, it was like, I couldn't find it, just a second.
Because there you need to pay for the membership, and then once you pay the membership, you can actually, you get the insurance with it, you know, and you can be anywhere in the world, but I forgot the name, I have it. Alpena, yeah. Open the rate. And Skyscanner is the most important one. Most of all, like if you look for some flight ticket, then look for the 1 month. Try to stay flexible. And you know, like you will see the cheapest rates, you know, during that month. So you can always find really cheap flights. For example, I already checked, you know, my way to Las Vegas, and there's a flight from Stockholm and from Copenhagen to Las Vegas, direct flight. For 3,000 crowns, only 3,000, one way trip, of course, I'm not going back, right, this way. But I mean, you can get, and it's regular, it happens like every month, this kind of rate. So you can save a lot of money, actually, just even with Skyscanner. You don't need any special rates, you just need to stay flexible, and you need to, you know, like, have a wide range of looking, you know, like a huge radius. So that means that you don't say, like, I want to leave on 12, and hopefully I'll see you some other time. And good luck on your next journey. Goodbye.